spatial political issue voting. And I'm particularly interested in looking at how the issue voting, the impact of issue preferences and policy evaluations varies across contexts and across borders. And in this paper, looking more particularly at the role of policy identification, how policy identification may influence the degree to which voters rely on issues to evaluate politics. So I start with spatial spatial models of competition, and in particular the so-called unified or hybrid models of competition, which include policy identification. So these models are based on the idea that all voters react to the issue positions of parties, that voting preferences are influenced by the issue distance between voters and parties, so that party identification in addition will give a bonus to one of the both. These unified models are based on a central assumption, the idea that the two effects are additive. That is, they are based on the idea that some voters have a party identification that gives a bonus to one of the parties, but otherwise all voters respond in the same way to issue preferences, to parties' positions. And in this paper, I suggest an alternative hypothesis. I make the hypothesis that the degree to which voters respond to issue position depends on party identification, that party identifiers should be less responsive to spatial factors or issue factors. So, to start with, can consider this equation which shows the traditional specification of a unified model of voter choice, so explaining the utility of a voter for a given party, and it depends on party identification and on the distances between voters and parties on a series of issue dimensions. The expectations would be that the effect of party identification is positive, identifying with the party will lead to higher utility for that party, and that the effect of issue distances would be negative. The further away from a party, the less likely you are to vote for that party, or the lower the utility for that party is going to be. Before modifying the role of party identification, the idea which I introduced before, that there should be an interaction effect between the two, I need to take care of one issue relating to the specification of this model. In this theoretical model, the dependent variable is the utility for a given party. When this model is estimated empirically, however, the dependent variable can be a party utility or it can be voting choice, depending on who some authors work with party utilities, other votes work with voting choice. The choice between the two usually is considered to be not really relevant in terms of model specification, but when thinking about party identification, there is actually an important difference. In this case, I'm working with party utilities, so I have for every voter the measure of the utility for the different parties in competition. It means that the observations in the other group of the model are not voters or respondents, they are combination of respondents by party. And in terms of party identification, it's necessary to distinguish between three types of respondent by party observation. It can be how an party identifier evaluates his or her preferred party, or he or she evaluates other parties, the party that is not identified with, or it can be the evaluation of a non-identifier for a given party. As I explained a bit more in detail in the paper, to capture these two the differences between these three types of relations, it's necessary to include not one party identification variable, but two, to make the distinction between how compared to non-identified, for example, to distinguish the effect on the party you identify with from the effect on the parties you don't identify with. So, with this modification, I come back to a slightly modified model of voting choice. It's similar to the previous model, except that I have two party identifications. And based on this model, I would expect still the effect of issue distances to turn the same direction, but to have two distinct effects of party identification. Positive effect on the body identifier with, a negative effect on the other parties. So, this preliminary aspect being discussed, I can turn to the main goal of the paper, which is to see how the effect of issue distances may depend on body identification. So, that quality identification represents a very salient attitude, something which should be very easily accessible to those who identify with quality. It should play an important role in their comparative evaluation of the different quality. So it should function like a heuristic in the voting decision process. And when voters have easily available heuristic, they tend to pay less attention to factors that require more systematic treatment. So my idea is that party identifiers should rely less strongly on issue distances than non-identifiers because they have an easily available heuristic on which to evaluate the different parties. So the impact of voter party issue distances should be weaker among party identifiers than among non-identifiers. Furthermore, I also consider two additional sources of variation in the impact of issue distances. One is political knowledge, political sophistication. The other is polarization. As regards political knowledge, we know that voters also differ in the degree to which they rely on issues. Voters' degree of political sophistication moderates the impact of issues on the vote. Voters who have a high degree of political sophistication tend to rely on stronger issues than voters who have a low degree of political knowledge. So the impact of party identification in reducing the effect of issue voting should be stronger among sophisticated voters. Among voters with a low level of knowledge, the impact of issues should be relatively weak among all voters, party identifiers and non-identifiers. So this conditional effect of sophisticated of party identification should further be conditioned by political sophistication. As regards the second variable, polarization, as Federico presented, there is a lot of literature showing how a higher degree of polarization leads to a stronger impact of ideological voting or issue voting. In this paper, I'm not comparing different actual contexts, but I'm comparing different issues on which parties may more or less polarize. So I expect that on issues on which parties take very different positions, the impact of these issues on the vote should be stronger than on issues on which parties tend to have more or less similar issue positions. To test these different hypotheses, I'm using data from four recent Dutch election studies. There are several reasons for this choice. One of the most important ones is to have a vertical system with many important issues which increase the number of implications of the hypothesis. And I have, depending on the election studies, party utilities from four to six parties measured on and their issue position and also party issue distances being measured from six to seven issue dimensions. At the individual level, I explain party utilities by issue distances, party identification, and sophistication. And I expect sophistication and party identification to condition the impact of issue distances that have followed interaction between these different variables. Then at the contextual level of the local at the party system level, I expect the degree of issue-specific polarization for a given issue to also to moderate the strength of issue distances. So we have a sort of set of cross-level interactions between the impact of issues and the degree of polarization. I'm estimating this model with a two-step estimation procedure, which has been suggested among others by Leon. I will present the results in several steps. First, I will forget about the role of polarization and about the role of sophistication, and look only at how issue voting may depend on tries rather an exception compared to all the issues that we have 28 issues for election. There is only only two or three of them for which the effect is not significant. If you compare this to policy identifiers, you do find different reasons. The light gray line, the third line for each issue, show the corresponding effect on party identifiers' evaluation of their preferred party, the party they do identify. And what we can see is that this party utility is not related to issue distance. Voters who do identify with the party don't think the probability that identifier vote for their preferred party. It may vary, it's usually relatively high, but it varies a little bit, but this variation is unrelated. There doesn't seem to be any effect of issue decency on how identifiers evaluate the preferred party. And if you look at the third type of relation, that is how identifiers evaluate the party they do not, with which they do not identify, there is some effect of issue decency, but it tends to be less systematic and weaker than among non-identifiers. So this shows that party identifier plays this moderating can observe this moderated impact. The impact of issues is strongest for non-identifiers, it is non-existent for all identifiers evaluated the preferred party, and it is there is an effect of a weaker one for all identifiers evaluated on the board. The next question then is to see how these effects of issue distances vary with voters' degree of political sophistication and how they vary with the degree of polarization of issues. To show this, I will first look only at non-identifiers. So, coming back to the previous slide, we have seen here that for most issues there is a strong and significant strong effect of issue distances on this party evaluation. Now, this graph shows how the size of this effect varies with polarization and how it varies with voters' degree of political sophistication. So, the left-hand panel shows the predicted effect for voters with low level. The right-hand panel shows the corresponding index for voters with a higher level of political sophistication. And in both graphs, the horizontal axis shows the degree of issue-specific polarization. Issues on the left are issues on which parties tend to take the same position. Issues on the right are issues on which parties diverge strongly in their initial graphs. So, looking first at the effect of polarization, we see in both groups of voters that polarization reinforces expect from the literature, from the comparative literature on the relation between polarization and issue voting. Comparing the two graphs, it's also seen that this further depends on voters' degree of political sophistication. The reinforcement effect of polarization is strongest among voters with a high level of political sophistication. They are more sensitive to variation in the degree of polarization. So these are results for non-identified. We're going to see what are the corresponding reasons for party identifiers. Looking first at how party identifiers evaluate their preferred party. From the previous graph, we have shown that it tends to be non-unrelated to issue distances. This graph further shows that this negative result holds both for voters with low level of sophistication and for voters with high level of sophistication, and it holds for polarized and non-polarized issues. Among how party identifiers evaluate their party really is entirely unrelated to the relative position of voters and this party in the issue space. The third situation is how party identifiers evaluate the party that they do not identify with. In this case, we do observe the effect of polarization, like on the non-identifiers. But the effect is slightly weaker. They do respond to differences in the level of polarization, but they don't do so as strongly as do non-identifiers. The other difference we notice is that political sophistication is that here doesn't play any role. Voters with a low level of political sophistication, voters with a high level of political sophistication, respond in the same way to voter politician. So to conclude shortly, there is strong support for the idea that the impact of issue distances is conditional the standard assumption of unified model that the two types of effects are additive really doesn't seem to be supported. But we also see that it's not a black and white contrast between faulty identifier and non-identifier. The effect is strongest among non-identifiers, as they expected. Among identifiers, there are differences between the different type of faults, the one with which they identify and the one with which they do not identify. And turning to the effect of sophistication and of polarization, including also these two factors, show that the gap between the differences between identifiers and non-identifiers becomes stronger as polarization increases, and they become stronger